Michalis Stratis, δικηγόρο και καθηγητή, δάσκαλο. He's a proud Brooklyn native, born in Bay Ridge and a member of the Holy Cross community. He became an English scout and was proclaimed a reader in the church. He graduated with a Bachelor of Arts in Fordham University and a Juris Doctorate from Sutton Hall Law School. He is a member of the New Jersey Bar Association. He switched careers and he became a teacher of history. He taught for many years at New Utrecht High School in Bensonhurst, Brooklyn. In 2001, he was appointed a teacher at Garden City High School in Nassau County. He has lectured on the subject of the Christian Holocaust of Asia Minor on behalf of the Asia Minor Christian Holocaust Committee. He has also been a proud member of the Pan-Macedonian Association for 20 years. He is also the producer and host of musical masterworks on Hellenic Public Radio Cosmos FM 91.5. He is a holy member of the Holy Cross Church in Whitestone, Queens. And he is a beautiful wife, Martha. He has a beautiful Martha, a wife, Mike, excuse me, are the proud parents for two sons, Dimitrios and Fotios. They happily reside in Western Queens. And proudly, I am presenting to you Mr. Michael Stratis.
Greece, 1912. A map of but a portion of the Greek-speaking world. With the Ottoman Empire still clinging to its Balkan territories, though somewhat reduced since the 19th century, the Greek, Serbian, Bulgarian, Montenegrin, and Romanian states still hoped to reclaim their traditional lands. The Glücksburg dynasty of King George I had steered the new Greek kingdom into the 20th century. His arrival in Greece in 1863 had come at a critical time. There was an overthrow of the Bavarian King Otho and his wife, the persistent bankruptcy of the Greek government, the political intrigues and ministries, and the many failed attempts of the Greeks outside of the kingdom to join the Greek state. All these made running the government very difficult. But surprisingly, King George brought many good things. The Ionian Islands, the expansion into Thessalia in 1881, and the effective ministry of the great Greek politician Charilaos Trikoupis. But lately, the fortunes of Greece had suffered a devastating defeat in the Greco-Turkish War of 1897. Here are some stills from that time. A big disappointment for Greece. At the same time, the Cretan question was showing signs of hope. In 1898, Crete was turned into an autonomous state ruled by the High Commissioner, Prince George, and a committee of Cretan personalities, among them the influential Eleftherios Venizelos, the then Minister of Justice. In its new diplomatic capacity, the Cretan state began to participate in the affairs of the Greek state, most notably in the Ottoman territories of Macedonia. Cretan warriors volunteered to scout the area and defend the villages for the benefit of the Greek population. There we have the first Cretan volunteers who served in Macedonia with the recommendation of the great Venizelos. Here, these Greeks were engaged in a full-scale conflict with the Bulgarian bands, the Komitadzidas, and propagandists. Among the many who led the Greek cause in the Macedonian struggle were the Slav-speaking Greek Kotas. The zealous Metropolitan of Kastoria, Germanos Karavagelis. and the heroic Pablos Melas, a military officer who had inspired the natives with his example. With his death, many Greeks, both native and free, dedicated their lives to defending the Greek populations until the outbreak of the Young Turk Revolution of 1908. And here we have Capitan Yanglis from Yeriso, Lazos Apostolidis, Capitan Lucas, and here are the volunteers from Free Greece. Capitan Korakas, Capitan Sotakis, Capitan Dukas Gaitadzis, and a tribute to the Kritis once more. With the overthrow of the Turkish Sultan Abdulhamid II, the Young Turks created a message of renewal that even inspired the Greek state to put a similar plan into action. The result was the famous Goudi coup of 1909. Several junior army officers, headed by the Colonel Nikolaos Zorbas, presented demands to the king that a reform of the political and military system should take place. After delays and a large public demonstration, the officers, known as the Military League, tried to recruit Venizelos as a possible prime minister. It was not until elections were held in 1910 that Venizelos was elected prime minister and a program for reforms was put into effect. This included, among many things, a thorough military program which introduced French military advisors, the purchase of naval vessels, an upgrade of artillery and weaponry, and the development of an air force. These were to play a critical part in the years ahead. And the greatest, most impressive achievement of the Venizelos ministry was the conclusion of a Balkan League alliance. You could see here with the nations of Bulgaria, top left, Serbia, bottom right, and Montenegro, top right, against the Ottoman state. With some Russian support and optimism following the defeat of the Turks in the Italo-Turkish War of 1911, the Balkan states worked together to provoke a cause for military action. This came when their request that they be allowed to monitor their own minorities in the Balkans was soundly rejected by the Turks. Thus, on October 8, 1912, the First Balkan War began. It was expected that the Ottoman territories would be carved up with a very informal plan. The Montenegrins and the Serbians, you see Montenegro on the left, Serbia right over there, they were supposed to basically attack the Sanjak and Novi Pazar. Epiros, it seemed, would satisfy the Greeks, while the Greeks and Bulgarians made some indication that they would expand into other territories following the rule, first come, first serve. The unspoken name, of course, was Macedonia, the target of this informal agreement. And so the Balkan Wars begin, October 8, 1912, with a declaration of war first by Montenegro. The Greek armed forces were commanded by the crown prince, Diadochos Konstantinos, a respected and deeply committed leader who came to represent the hopes of the military party in Athens. While Greece was viewed as the weakest of the Balkan allies, in fact, one British consul said, if there is a war, we shall probably see that the only thing Greek officers can do besides talk is run away. Greece was also viewed as the only naval power of the alliance. Constantine also loved his role of commander-in-chief because he had been influenced by the vision of the Megali Idea, the nationalist prediction that he would lead the Greek world back to Constantinople and be the first to celebrate the first Orthodox liturgy in the Hagia Sophia in a reconstituted Eastern Roman Empire. As the dynamic successor to the crown, Constantine employed many of these popular expectations to his benefit. Aiding him in his national ambitions were then Major General Panayotis Danglis, a recognized expert in artillery, as his chief of staff, and Lieutenant General Konstantinos Sapuntzakis, a Cretan officer specializing in military technology who had served in the War of 1897. The Crown Prince divided his forces into two branches, the Army of Thessaly, comprising the bulk of the Greek army, about 100,000 soldiers led directly by him. And you could see the names of the generals for each division. And the second one, the army of Epiros, about 13,000 infantry, Evzonus, and National Guard battalions led by Sapuntzakis. Added to this force were two Cretan battalions and an Italian volunteer battalion of Garibaldini, which had already formidably fought in the War of 1897 on the Greek side. The Royal Hellenic Navy was led by the great admiral from Idra, Pavlos Kunduriotis. Kunduriotis had a long career of impressive achievements. He was the first to commandeer a Greek vessel across the Atlantic in 1901. That year, 1911 that is, he went to Britain in the name of the government and took command of the world-famous armored cruiser Averroes, the flagship of the Navy. As Rear Admiral and Commander-in-Chief of the Navy, Kunduriotis was to witness some of the greatest naval engagements in modern Greek history. His fleet was exceptional and presented an advantage which would create a variety of possibilities in future campaigns. And here are the names of most of the vessels involved at this time. From the Averroes all the way down to the minesweeper Aris. And there's one I would like you to pay attention to, the torpedo boat number 11. Remember that one. Battle commenced on October 6th, 1912. The Crown Prince, always ready for the battle, advanced his forces into Thessaly with the goal of cutting off the main routes northwards. This brought them to their first engagement in Elassona. Here, after a four-hour battle filled with the sound of artillery battering the Turkish positions and the Evzones charging the enemy lines, the Ottomans abandoned their guns and ammunition and fled towards Servia. It was reported that their greatest priority during their flight was the transport of the local harem girls. At the end of the day, the Greeks had liberated their first town and were again on the move. And here's some of the Palikaria that fought in that battle. Meanwhile, forces had advanced to the Skati, outside of Kalabaka, and fought the Turks for an entire day, at the end of which the enemy forces had retreated to their fortified positions at the famous Sarandaporo Pass. Five Greek divisions reached Sarandaporo and were confronted by a heavily fortified Turkish position made up of five divisions with a reserve of 11 more. The pass had been fortified by a German mission some time before. It had substantial artillery and three machine gun companies. The Greek offensive began with a full frontal attack and a flanking move, attempting to bypass the Turkish fortifications and to attack the rear positions. General Hasan Tahsin Pasha's powerful force began by opening artillery fire. The Greek 4th and 5th Division pushed back the Turkish flank. The 4th earned the distinctive nickname, the Winged Division, for their speed. With Major Ioannis Velisario's 9th Evzon Battalion capturing the town of Niskati, the Turks managed to pull off a nighttime retreat to avoid being captured completely by the 4th that encircled them. Though a limited success, the Greek victory at Sarandaporo was not a thing to be laughed about. It sent a message to the Balkan allies that Greece was not a second-rate military power. More importantly, it proved to the German military advisor, Wilhelm Freiherr von der Glotz, that he was wrong when he pronounced that Sarandaporo would mark the northernmost advance of the Greek forces, and that Sarandaporo would become the graveyard of the Greek army. That's what he said, that the Greeks would all be buried there. On October 10th, the Greek army entered the Porta Pass, Astenatis Portas, and easily defeated the defending Turkish force and recovered several major artillery pieces. With this, the army liberates the town of Servia after retreating Turkish forces murder 117 imprisoned Greeks from the surrounding region. At sea, the Greek Navy, the Hellenic Royal Navy, had as its first objective the capture of the northern Aegean island of Limnos. Knowing full well the value of Thucydides' famous phrase, Mera totis thalassis kratos, translated as great is the power of the maritime state, Admiral Kunduriotis ordered the advance to the island and immediately set up a naval base in the town of Mudros. This served as the maritime headquarters for all Aegean operations. And there you could see a gathering on the Averof. That might actually be after Nayazmo. Having cleared the major approaches to the Olympus and Pieria ranges, the Greek army began to expand its territorial control. On October 11th, they approached the town of Gribovo. Here, the front was covered by the forces of Sapunzakis, who occupied the heights of Gribovo outside of Arta. And with 11,000 infantry and Evzones, not to mention Cretan and Epirotes volunteers, they took up defensive positions. The Ottomans, seeking to divert attention of the bulk of the enemy force, made some movements away from the area and then ambushed several groups of Greek Evzones. Luckily, the Greek forces managed to knock away the bulk of the Turkish forces. By the next 2 days, the Turks had disappeared from the area. Having cleared the major approaches to the Olympos and Pieria ranges, the Greek army began to expand its territorial control. On October 11th, the town of Kozani woke to news that the Turkish authorities had fled during the night. They abandoned weapons, munitions, food supplies, and medicines. The Kozanites celebrated by firing weapons into the air. This caught the attention of a Greek scout and the royal cavalry, which galloped at full speed to intercept any possible conflict. So they got nervous. Hearing the sound of horses, the Kozanites wandered to the town's entrance and beheld the arrival of the Greek horsemen. Residents wandered around from house to house announcing the news to the old people with the words, Papu, ήρθε το ελληνικό, to which their response in many cases was, Ora as pethanome. By October 15th, and here we have a picture of some Kozanites holding the guns, especially the woman in the front, holding the guns they captured from the Turkish arsenal. And there is the celebration after the army came in. By October 15th, the Crown Prince ordered troops towards Kailari, today's Ptolemaida, which the Turkish forces of Kozani now occupied. Though the small Turkish force did open fire, the superior gun power of the Greek forces persuaded them to surrender. At the same time, forces were making their way into the Grevena region, which had recently experienced a tragic event. Almost a year before, the beloved Mitropoliti Emilianos Lazaridis, who had distinguished himself with his love of the people and of the church, was found murdered and mutilated in a nearby forest, probably at the hands of the Turks or their allies. With the death of the ethnomartyr, the Greeks had been plunged into a state of despair. That is, until the 15th of October, 1912, when the former Macedonian fighter, Georgios Katehakis, while out scouting in the area, sent word that freedom was coming. As the former Capitan Ruvas, Katehakis had a great knowledge of the area and was much loved. It was he who led the Cretan soldiers to the gates of the town, which had by now been abandoned by the Turks. A celebrating crowd went wild when they appeared, and flowers and fezes, tofesi, you know, they threw them in the streets under their fika tapatusa. They were stepping on the fesia. With the arrival of the Evzoni, the town was officially claimed in the name of King George and the Greek nation. The celebrations lasted into the next year, and during one of these major celebrations, the dying native fighter, Lukas Kokinos, Capitan Lukas, who had never recovered from his wounds in the Macedonian struggle, happily acknowledged the fortunate event and died as he heard the sounds of the song that had been written for him. Ena poulakia kathese stou lechovou tirai. Over on the coast of Pieria, the seafaring town of Litochoro, which had rebelled many times in the past, most recently 1878, was also celebrating as the first scouts poured into the city on October 16th. The 7th Infantry Division entered the town, and many of the local mariners, I Capitanei, openly volunteered to carry out any naval operations that were needed. Since Litochoro was a known naval power in their area, Kunduriotis sent several vessels into the vicinity to take in many of these skilled sea captains, some of which we will mention later. One particular native who was thrilled was Ioannis Sakellaridis, the famed musicologist, who was so excited that he sent a message to his son, the even more famous composer of Greek operetta, Theophrastos Sakellaridis, and through the inspiration he received, he wrote some of the pieces we are hearing here tonight, including the one that you're hearing now, from the opera, from the operetta of Vaftistikos, in honor of this great event. The dramatic liberation of Katerini also took place on the 16th. The difficulty here was that Turkish forces had taken defensive positions in the village of Kolokuri and ambushed the 7th Division. Colonel Dimitrios Voronos, who tried to retrieve the difficult situation, galloped on horseback back and forth across the lines, telling his men to fire back. Seeing him, the Turks fired their guns and fatally wounded him. But before he died, he still stuck to his saddle, and this did not prevent him from continuing his task until finally, without any life left, he fell off his horse and died. His men rallied, and eventually the Turks made their retreat across the river Pelekas. In honor of his heroism, the village of Kolokuri was renamed Zvoronos. The 7th finally made its way into the town of Katerini, where, without any incident, they were greeted with enthusiasm by the Mitropoliti του Κύπρου, Parthenios Vardakas, the fiery churchman who led the region during the difficult years of the Macedonian struggle with his patriotic sermons, and his relentless struggle against Romanian propagandists trying to win over the local Vlachs, the Vlachi. For this, he had survived at least 3 assassination attempts. Now, he was celebrating Thea Liturgia in the Church of the Holy Ascension in a free Pieria. That same day, the ancient metropolis of Veria is also liberated, as well as the city of Nausa. At a confident pace, Greek forces are overrunning the western and central portions of Macedonia. During those critical days, a daring naval mission was being prepared in the town of Litochoro. and it involved a secret entry into the port city of Thessaloniki through the Thermaiko Kolpo. Lieutenant Nikolaos Votsis, the nephew of Admiral Kunduriotis, had collected several experienced sea captains and made their way in torpedo boat 11, the one I told you about, into the Thermaic Gulf. The prized battleship, the Turkish battleship Fetihi Bulent, was quietly anchored there. As they made their way in the black of night, they were confronted by searchlights, which surprisingly did not detect the torpedo boat. As it slipped by, Votsis ordered the firing of torpedoes into the right flank of the ship. After scoring a direct hit, a second torpedo finished it off on the left flank. The sinking of the prize vessel was a major blow to the Turkish morale in Thessaloniki and in the high command of the Ottoman Navy. For his heroism, the great Votsis was celebrated, and a statue of him would be placed in later years before the famous Lefko Pirgo in Thessaloniki. Everybody gets to see that and take pictures there. Votsis observed that the mission could not have been pulled off if it were not for the brave captains of his ships, two famous captains from Litohoro, Mikhail Kofos and Nikolaos Vlachopoulos. These two men were responsible for coordinating the event, and their skill made it possible. Today, their statues are displayed in the Naftiko Museo Litohoro. And now we move on into the Aegean. On that same day, the Greek fleet stationed in Mudros had liberated the islands of Thassos and Imbros. The next day, three battleships approached the island of Samothrake and landed a detachment of armed sailors who captured the island. The same was also repeated in Agios Evstratios. It was becoming quite clear by now that the crown prince was in a position to make an advance on Thessaloniki. But Constantine, however, was focused on the recovery of the city of Monastiri. Prime Minister Venizelos began to slowly make clear his ideas that the army should move towards the Muslim holy site of Yanitsa with an eye to the great Macedonian metropolis. To do so, Constantine would have to dispel a major Turkish force blocking his progress. Thus, the Greek army moved with six infantry divisions against a force of 25,000 Turkish troops and 30 guns defending the narrow path leading from Yanitsa to Mount Baiko, to the town itself. On the morning of October 19th, the men of the Greek 2nd and 3rd Infantry Division, while subjected to constant artillery fire, advanced under a heavy rain and were very courageously moving ahead to dominate the open field. Greek artillery responded by barraging the Turks, who obstinately defended their positions. The next morning, the 9th Evzon Battalion, under Lieutenant Colonel Constantine Papadopoulos, occupied the heights at the entrance of the town. The Ottoman forces, upon seeing the Evzon colors raising up in the town, withdrew back towards Thessaloniki, and the Greeks achieved an impressive victory. Meanwhile, in Epiros, Sapunzakis' forces had made progress into the towns of Philippiava and Nicopolis, and were now moving to take Preveza, a well-fortified town, which was a coastal town. Greek operations began with a siege of the town, which included land, naval, and aerial bombardments. The Turkish defenses were overwhelmed after much bombardment, and the city was taken by Greek troops on the 21st of October, 1912. As you can see here, there are the Greek troops getting off the ships. And soon they move into the town, and finally the celebration begins. In the town of Nigrita, near Sedis, there was talk of Bulgarians arriving. This made the high command in Epiros a little nervous because they thought they would be diverted towards the Macedonian front. But it turns out that Sapunzakis had enough confidence to pursue the next goal, which was Bende Pigalia. There, Major General Esad Pasa desperately tried to slow down the Greek progress in the secondary theater by setting up his headquarters at Bende Pigalia. A Greek force of about 8,000 soldiers arrived and found itself attacked by the entrenched enemy. Everybody got into the battle, including the local priest. Due to bad weather and the arrival of snow, the Turkish attack lost steam and ended with the Ottomans retreating 7 days later. So, what was going on in Nigrita? Well, good news was actually going on in Nigrita near Metseres. Here, the Macedonian fighter, Georgios Yanglis and Lukas Gaitadzis, led their men in separate attacks on the Turks. While Lukas controlled the Pangaean range, Yanglis and his men heroically defeated enemy forces and liberated the town of Nigrita by October 23rd. This marked a strategic victory for the Greeks in that it presented a buffer, which the nearby Bulgarian forces could not go around easily, and thus they could make their way to Thessaloniki. And of course, the Turks, realizing this was a problem, began to see if they could negotiate with the Bulgarians, but the Bulgarians were too far away. And so all of this was slowed down for the benefit of the Greek army. Over in Western Macedonia, the 5th Infantry Division was advancing towards the city of Monastiri, where it hoped to link up with the Serbs. While advancing, it was caught unaware near Banica, modern Vevi, by the Ottoman 6th Army Corps. Isolated and outnumbered, the Greeks fell back towards Sorovitz, modern Amindeon, where, after a few days of successful resistance, the Greek forces were beaten once again and retreated towards Kozani. Thus, the chance to take Monastiri was fading away. One positive note, the famous native Makedonomacho, Kapitan Stavros Kotsopoulos, who had resisted the Bulgarians in the years before and had even escaped twice to America, returned to organize a band and continued to fight any Bulgarian he met on the road while also fighting the Turks. This helped clear much of the area of anti-Greek propaganda and helped contribute to the renewal of Greek power. I love these photographs, they're so beautiful, aren't they? With this turn of events, Venizelos once again reminded the Crown Prince of the urgency to take Thessaloniki. After producing diplomatic evidence and recruiting the support of the king, Venizelos ordered Constantine to advance at all costs. One of the difficulties encountered by the Crown Prince was that the Turks destroyed many bridges leading to the great city. With alarming speed, the Greek forces made their way and immediately launched negotiations for the surrender of Thessaloniki. Turkish General Hasan Taksim Pasha, commanding officer of the Turkish garrison, negotiated with two Greek officers. Now, you'd be surprised who the guy on the left is. Take a look. The first one, Officer Ioannis Metaxas, a young Metaxas, and Viktoras Vuzmanis, on the terms of the surrender. Isn't that amazing? Eventually, Taksim Pasha accepted the Greek terms, and 26,000 Ottoman soldiers passed away into Greek captivity. A Bulgarian offer of terms to surrender the city was turned away by the Pasha, who memorably responded, "I only have one city to surrender." On the feast of Saint Demetrius, the patron saint of the city, Greek troops entered the Macedonian capital to the cheers of the Greek population. The excitement reached a pinnacle when the great politician Ion Dragoumis, one of the masterminds of the Macedonian struggle, and the son of the first Macedonian Prime Minister, Stefanos Dragoumis, was honored with a very special task. He was given the task of raising the Greek flag from the balcony of the Greek consulate, and later on it was repeated on the Lefko Pyrgo. With tears in his eyes, Dragoumis had witnessed the dream of a lifetime. Soon, King George entered the city on horseback. The Bulgarians requested to enter the city, and it was rejected by the Crown Prince Costadino. Eventually, permission was only granted when the king arrived, the king of Bulgaria, to the two young Bulgarian princes and a small group of troops. This event was to prove a sore point for the Bulgarians and the cause of hostilities in the next year. On November 2nd, the Hellenic Royal Navy ordered the cruiser Averof to arrive to Mount Athos and to free it. Mount Athos stood in danger of being overrun by Bulgarian forces. With the assistance of an armed band of monks, the Greek naval force arrived and raised the Greek flag. I love seeing papadas with bullets across the chest. Okay. So, on November 4th, the inhabitants of the town of Shatsta. Now, I have to tell you something. I didn't know this. But the town Shatsta, or Shatista, is derived from a German word. In German, the Greeks of Shatista, known originally as Floropolis, went to Vienna and other German cities and talked about their town being a very, very rich town. So the Germans kept saying, oh, you're from the rich town, which in German is Schatzstadt. Schatzstadt. So, ήρθαν οι Σιατιστινοί πίσω στη Σιατστα και λέγανε, ah, Schatzstadt. And that's where the name came from. Well, anyway, I would never have thought the Germans would have been responsible for that. Anyway, the people of the town began a major attack on the Turks in their own city. This encouraged the arriving 5,000-man Greek army to join in, and with the aid of local scouts and Cretan volunteers, they defeated the Turkish forces in the town. It was here that the heroic Georgios Kapitsinis, Lakonas, who was a mathematician and an officer, who had migrated to California, made money, but returned to fight in 1912, led his Cretan troops in the taking of the elevation known as Kastraki, but sadly, he was shot in the forehead and soon died thereafter. And so we have a hero. On the same day, the brave island of Ikaria, which had already rebelled and rid the Turkish garrison of the island in one night, on the night of July 17, 1912, proclaimed union with Greece. One of the casualties was the local hero from Evdilos, Georgios Spanos. Ikaria had already tasted liberty as a free state, but the arrival of the Greek fleet restored the opportunity for the government of the island to vote, and so Ikaria joined Greece on that day. Now, we go to Arnisa, back to the Macedonian front. In the aftermath of the Greek defeat at Vevi and Amyndion, the Greek high command ordered the 1st, the 3rd, the 4th, and the 6th divisions into the town of Skidra. On November 4th, battle began in Arnisa, then known as Ostrovo. And by the next day, the Greeks had scored a major victory. This success made possible the retaking of Amyndion and soon Florina. On November 5th, a Greek volunteer force made up of Epirotes and 200 Cretans under the former Macedonian fighter, Makedonomachos, Major Spiridon Spiromelios, raised a revolt which led to the liberation of Himara after a brief battle with the local Ottoman troops. So Himara is freed. Over in the North Aegean, on November 7th, the town of Florina witnessed the victory of the 1st Cavalry Regiment over the local Turkish forces. This was followed by an interesting negotiation of surrender terms between the Turkish authorities, the Mitropoliti Polycarpos of Florina, and the Greek officer Ioannis Artis. After much clarification, the city was surrendered and the crown prince entered the city the next day. Over in the North Aegean, Admiral Kunduriotis was busily preparing the plan for the liberation of Lesbos. On November 8th, the feast of the archangels Michael and Gabriel, over 1,000 soldiers and 300 marines engaged in a firefight with a 2,000-strong Turkish garrison. Within hours, the Greeks entered the town of Mytilene and proclaimed victory. The last Turkish defenders on the island eventually surrendered on December 8th. On November 11th, the Greek fleet, made up of light cruisers and troop transporters, reached the island of Chios. A small party met with Zihni Bey, the commanding officer of the Ottoman garrison, and they offered him a chance to surrender, and he said, "No, I will not." Thus, the Greek warships began bombarding the Ottoman positions with their guns, and at the same time, disembarked 3 battalions under Colonel Nicolaos de la Gramaticas, and 40 Marines under Corporal Pafsanias Katsotas, while the residents of the town of Kardamila formed an armed band of 200 fighters under Michael Spithoyannis and rebelled against Turkish rule. Among the soldiers in the engagement was the Makedonomacho Evangelos Kukudeas of Stromnitsa, who had been among the rebels in Ikaria in July and was, until only a few days before, the governor general of Ikaria. He arrived in Chios with a band of Icarian volunteers and participated in the battles of Volissos and Aipus, which paved the path for the full liberation of the island by December 20th. And by the way, the song is Zito Averos, which they pronounce Averos. On the same day, on the feast of Ayomina, the warrior saint, the town of Kastoria woke up to the news that a Greek force had made camp in the nearby area and was preparing to make its entry. For several weeks, the Kastorians had disagreed on whether they should request the arrival of the Katihakis volunteer force in Vogatsiko or await for the arrival of the army. The arrival of Turkish troops, however, under Bekir Aga and Mehmet Pasa changed everything. But the Greek 1st Cavalry Regiment restored hope, agreeing to send 3 spies into the town to check up on the situation. The Greeks waited. It turned out that these 3 had made very important contacts and started a discussion on the terms of surrender. The leading Turkish officers decided to give up Kastoria. Once Mehmet Pasa had agreed to surrender terms, the Greek force entered with the great Macedonian personality Philolaos Picheon, the famous Picheon, who was the head of several horsemen, and proclaimed the liberation of Kastoria. This famous Philolaos Picheon, who raised the flag of Greece for the first time in Kastoria, was the son of one of the leading supporters of the Greek cause in the Macedonian struggle, the old Anastasios Picheon. Once the town was in Greek hands, Picheon, with a smile on his face, said, "Now I can die peacefully," and he too, in the next year, died peacefully. So Kastoria is free. And with that, much of Macedonia in the west and in the central locations have been free. Now, with the operations of the Macedonian front reduced, there was going to be an issue. The crown prince, Constantine, transferred much of his forces at this moment into Epiros, into the Epiros front. Taking command of the forces, Constantine began by attacking the heavily fortified town of Drisko, right outside of Yanina. And here, a fierce battle between the Turks and the Garibaldini, the Italian volunteers, who were also joined by Greek volunteers, fighting together under the grandson of the great Italian patriot Giuseppe Garibaldi. I speak of his grandson Peppino Garibaldi. And he, with the Greek from Zakynthos, Alexandros Romas, put together a full-scale attack on the forces there. While the Ottomans held fast, the Greco-Italian forces, led by Peppino and by Romas, offered great resistance and overwhelmed much of the enemy artillery. Sadly, however, after this victory, there was some bad news. The bad news was that one of the most famous poets of the time, a man who had reached his 53rd year, a poet, a parliamentarian, and a champion chess player, Lorenzos Mavilis, had taken a bullet and was slowly passing away. The sad thing about the death of Mavilis, and it was reported at the time, he made a statement to the effect that I wish I could have done more, but up until here, I'm satisfied. And with that, Michalis died, and so another hero enters the books with his death. Now, things change here. In the first major naval engagement of the war, the 9-ship Ottoman fleet sailed to the entrance of the Dardanelles, the Dardanelles, with the hope of engaging the 8-vessel Greek fleet off of Imbros. Admiral Kunduriottis had recently sent them a threatening message, and it said, "We are waiting for you." Nice little threat. On the Averof, Kunduriottis responded by signaling his fleet with the message, "By the power of God, and with the wishes of the king, and in the name of justice, I sail with unstoppable force and with confidence of victory against the enemy of the nation." But he was very disappointed by the slow speed of the 3 older battleships. So the Greek admiral raised a flag signal for independent action, and he cut across the enemy's fleet formation and swiftly steamed forward against the Ottoman flagship, the Barbaros Hayreddin. Under fire from 2 sides, the Ottomans were quickly forced to retreat to the Dardanelles. The whole engagement lasted about an hour, in which the Ottomans suffered heavy damage to their flagship, 18 dead and 41 wounded. And the Greeks, 1 dead and 7 wounded. While that's going on in Macedonia, some of the forces that had been reorganized under Major General Konstantinos Damianos crossed into northern Epirus and attacked the 24,000 troops of the Ottoman garrison of Koritsa on December 7th. The Turks tried to negotiate their retreat, but were eventually pushed out of the town. With the victory, the Greek forces began to put pressure around Yanina, the last major Ottoman base in the area. Now, on December 7th, the Greek submarine Delfin, the first submarine in the Greek Navy's history, made history by being the first torpedo boat to actually fire a torpedo against an enemy ship. This is in the Guinness Book of World Records. The first torpedo fired by a submarine is by this submarine, the Delfini. Though the Ottoman light cruiser Mecidiye was targeted, luckily it escaped any kind of impact. But by the first day of the new year, 1913, the disappointed Ottoman fleet of Ramiz Bey grew impatient. They had pursued a policy of not fighting, but failed at Porto Heli. In desperation, they succeeded in getting the Ottoman cruiser Hamidiye past the straits so as to lure the Averof away from the Dardanelles. Kunduriottis easily realized the purpose of this mission and refused to follow. He did, however, anticipate the advance of the Ottoman fleet and prepared battle plans. On January 5th, just 12 miles southeast of Limnos, the 11-ship Greek fleet advanced in columns with the Averof in the front. The two sides exchanged fire, and the Ottomans took much damage. As they made their way back to the Dardanelles, the Averof independently pursued and forced the enemy back into the straits. The Turks, fearing the Averof, which they called the devil's ship, Saitan Vapor, never came out again for the rest of the war and assured Greek control of the Aegean. Now, here's an interesting event after Kunduriottis gained such a tremendous double victory. The withdrawal had to be checked out. So, the first mission of this new force in the armed forces, the Air Force, was about to be used. Now, it had been used before, but for the first time, they sent the first lieutenant, Michael Moutousis, and ensign Aristides Moraitinis on January 24th, 1913. They conducted a naval aviation mission, flying their Maurice Farman hydroplane over the Nagara naval base. And there, they spotted the enemy fleet. During their sortie, they drew a diagram of the positions of the Ottoman fleet, against which they dropped 4 bombs. Oops, I went too far. Moutousis and Moraitinis traveled over 180 kilometers, 111 miles, and took 140 minutes to complete their mission. though they did not score anything else in terms of hits. This operation is regarded as the first naval air operation in military history. It inspired many Greeks to join the Air Force. Some of you in here might have been in the Air Force. I know one for sure. And established a new branch of the Greek armed forces. Men like Karamanlakis, and look at this one, Karamberos. That guy has such an amazing Air Force look. And so, history is made again. After transferring three divisions into the Epiros Theater, στο Ηπειρωτικό Μέτωπο, raising the total troops to 40,000, along with 80 pieces of artillery and 6 aircraft, Crown Prince Constantine launched a full attack on the heavily fortified Turkish fortresses in Bizani and Kastritsa. From February 19th to the 22nd, the Battle of Bizani raged on until the fortresses were cut off and isolated. As a result, the Turkish officer Esad Pasha agreed upon the unconditional surrender of Yanina and the Ottoman garrison to the Greeks. This took place as a result of this battle. The Greek army inflicted some 2,800 Ottoman casualties and captured an additional 1,000 officers and 32,000 other military ranks. That's an amazing surrender and capture rate. During the battle, the Greeks lost the well-known Cypriot mayor from Limassos, Christodoulos Sozos, whose brilliant example as soldier and administrator inspired many people. And his words, if you read them, are truly very inspiring, and I wish some politician would listen to them today. And so the Cypriot mayor is killed in Bizani. Now, one of the most fascinating personalities of the Bizani campaign was actually a woman, a painter. A woman named Thalia Flora Caravia, a brave painter from Sciatista, who had actually volunteered to draw illustrations from the battlefront for local newspapers. She caused quite a stir with her presence among the men, and often seemed too caught up in her work to notice the dangers around her. Her great works were so much in demand that she later became a highly paid portrait artist. Some of the lithographs, drawings, and paintings that she made will be seen throughout this presentation. And to my surprise, about a year ago, some of her paintings were being auctioned at Sotheby's. This painter from Sciatista. Well, here comes February 22nd. The Greek army entered Yanina. After securing the surrender of the city, Constantine had written to the king and the prime minister, commending the heroism of his men, particularly the dauntless Colonel Ioannis Venisariu. After a triumphal entry, Constantine and his staff planned for the final push into northern Epirus. And here we see some of the interesting portrayals of the event, the famous lithographs of Stavridis. And this, by the way, is a painting by Tenan Mesare, a Turkish painter who was the son of the man who surrendered Thessaloniki. He actually lived in Greece, became a Greek citizen, and very proudly called himself a Greek. And here we have the king and his staff celebrating and preparing for the final push into northern Epirus. On March 2nd, the Greek Navy appeared off the coast of the autonomous state of Samos. The island had successfully received self-rule after it expelled the local administration under the leadership of native Themistocles Sophoulis. As the battleship Spetses, which was wandering around with other ships, approached, a Turkish garrison resisted their approach. After a landing party made its way through, they defeated the garrison, and Sophoulis' wise advice to his fellow Samians, his Samiotis, was for union with Greece as soon as possible. With that, Not only did Sofoulis become known as the father of his island, but he also prepared for a future career as a politician in Greece. And so, we move on now back to northern Epiros. From March 3rd to March 5th, the Greek Acheron Detachment, an independent unit that was made up of four infantry battalions and one artillery battery, liberated the city of Agi Saranda in northern Epiros, home to an ethnic Greek minority and one of the centers of the Greek minority of the region. The Greek 8th Infantry Division, under Crown Prince Constantine, took Velvino and Argyrokastro. By March 5th, the Epiros Cavalry Regiment of the 8th Infantry liberated Tepeleni. With these final actions, northern Epiros remained in Greek hands until, unfortunately, turned over to the new Albanian state in 1914. And so, Water Epiros goes back the other way. Sadly, on March 3rd, an assassin named Alexandros Hinas brought to an end the life of the king, King George, while he walked the streets of Thessaloniki. Though many concluded that Skinas was either an anarchist or simply crazy, some believed, some to this day, that he may have been part of a conspiracy to stop the monarch's successful involvement in the war. Following a major funeral, the Crown Prince Constantine was proclaimed king, King Constantine I, but he returned back to his military obligations to continue the oversight of the war. As for Skinas, well, it was reported that he later jumped to his death from a tall building. Another sad note, on April 4th, the pilot, Emmanuel Argyropoulos, and his Cretan observer, Konstantinos Manos, who was both a soldier and a poet, became the first victims of the Hellenic Aviation Service when their Blériot 11 plane crashed during a reconnaissance mission over Langada. And so sadly, these two men became the first victims of the Air Force, and both became heroes of the Greek people. So we come pretty much to the end of the First Balkan War. On May 17th, the London Conference began. Though officially the fighting had ceased on December 2nd, the Serbs and the Greeks had continued their advances until April 1913. At the conference, Prime Minister Venizelos got most of the territories that Greece had liberated. The Sultan gave up all title over Crete, and a new Turkish border was set at the Enos Media line. The Bulgarians, unfortunately, made themselves a very, very angry party when they talked about their disappointment that Macedonia had not been properly divided, and encouraged the Greeks and the Serbs to make common cause on the matter. The Greeks and the Serbs knew that this was trouble. While the treaty was signed, it became clear that Bulgaria was not going to settle for anything less than she demanded. And so, off we go to the Second Balkan War. On the morning of June 16th, at approximately 8:30 a.m., after many, many episodes of Bulgarian provocation, the Second Balkan War began with Bulgarian surprise attacks on the Greek town of Nigrita and the Serbian town of Yevgeli, without a previous declaration of war. At once, the king called his high command together to prepare for a response. At the same time, the Prime Minister Venizelos met with the Serbian king, re-established contact, and launched a successful counterattack which pushed the Bulgarians back in the town of Nigrita. On June 17th, a day after the Bulgarian surprise attacks against their former allies, and here you see some of the Bulgarians that were in the area, General Konstantinos Kalaris, commander-in-chief of the Greek forces, made up of the 2nd Infantry Division and the Cretan police force in Thessaloniki, sent a message to the commander of the Bulgarian forces in the city. And the message was, "Sir, since Bulgarian troops began hostilities in the countryside against our army, I have the honor to request you to leave the city of Thessaloniki 1 hour after the delivery of this letter. I like the way he says he had the honor of saying that. So the ultimatum was sent, and as expected, the Bulgarians ignored it and planned for their disarmament. The plans for their disarmament were initiated. On June 18th, after an all-night clash with some of the Bulgarians in the area and with the major role played by the Cretan police, 1,279 Bulgarians were taken prisoners. So much for their response. A day later, Greek forces came face to face with a large Bulgarian force in the area of Kikis. The 85,000 strong Greek army, made up of 73 infantry battalions, 33 field artillery battalions, 9 mountain artillery battalions, 8 cavalry squadrons, and 8 cavalry troops, was confronted by a 40,000 strong Bulgarian field army under Marshal Nikola Ivanov. This force was part of a line spanning from Lake Doirani to Kilkis, Lahana, Seres, and Mount Pangeo. And it had the advantage of being well fortified for some time. Now, the Greek army attacked across the plain with quick speed and pretty much under heavy artillery fire. They overran the Bulgarians, but suffered heavy losses from the enemy's guns. By the 20th, the Greeks had not yet broken the Bulgarian defense, but managed to maneuver their forces from Lahana, where they gained the upper hand, to reinforce the offensive. During the night, the Greeks attacked Kilkis after crossing the Galikos River, and 2 regiments broke through and entered the city. By morning, they were joined by the rest of the divisions and forced the Bulgarians into a retreat. In the meanwhile, Greek troops had entered Yevgeli, which the Bulgarians had taken from the Serbs on the 17th. So Greek casualties were high. About 6,000 had died in both offenses. And here we see the famous monument for the Battle of Kilkis-Lahana. On the 20th of June, Greek forces had achieved a victory in the village of Lingovani, near Langana. The Bulgarians under Petev had entered the village on the 18th and transported weapons in an attempt to make an advance on Thessaloniki. When hostilities broke out, the Bulgarians realized that they had a very bad position and began to order an evacuation of the village, taking most of the villagers with them. After killing several of the women and some leading Greek officials, they burned the village and tried to make their escape, but were intercepted. Of special interest, and this is very interesting, was the presence of Archbishop Makarios I of Cyprus, not the second, the first, who served as chaplain in the Greek force. One very interesting story from this time, which is really an inspiration, especially for the young people here, is the story of this 12-year-old Gerasimos Raftopoulos, the youngest army officer in Greek history. A native of Kefalonia, the teenager volunteered and was accepted as private of the 18th Infantry Regiment of the 4th Division. For his courage in the battles of Lazarades and Sarandaporo, he received a Mannlicher Schonauer rifle as a gift. In the Battle of Kilkis-Lahanas, he managed to escape from Bulgarian soldiers, killing 3 out of the 5 soldiers who were trying to catch him. On his way back, he found a wounded Evzona and carried him on his back to the Greek camp. For his bravery and his valor, he was promoted to the rank of corporal on August 28th at the age of 13. So guys, there's hope for you. Hopefully no battle. On June 22nd, the Greek army turned its attention to the Lake Doirani region, where one of the 3 remaining Bulgarian positions was present. The Greek 3rd and 10th divisions attacked the heights of Old Doirani, which is today in Skopje, and were met with heavy gunfire because of a lack of coordination. When both units made a combined effort, the Bulgarians were kicked out of the area. The Bulgarians fled into the town of Doirani and kidnapped several high-ranking officials, including Bishop Fotios of Poliani, before destroying the entire settlement. By nightfall, Greek control over the area had been established. Now, I show you this poster because it has a lot of meaning. It's called O Vulgarophagos. And if you don't know what he's doing, he's either eating his cheek or ripping his ear off. I did a little research, and it seems that when the Greeks found out that the Bulgarians were committing these massacres, these kidnappings, one soldier actually attempted this. So you could see the anger of the Greek population when they heard these massacres and atrocities. Says, "Etsi se kevokano etsi," and so he started to bite the face of this Bulgarian soldier. All right, so that's a memorable poster from that time. Okay, well, the Bulgarians fled to Stromnica, where other units had been chased from the town of Istip by the Serbs. Here they were attacked by the Greek forces from Doirani and had to face a powerful bayonet charge. This was because the Greek artillery could not be used in this rocky place. Realizing that they were close to being caught with a two-sided attack, the Bulgarians retreated to a second defense line at the foothills of Mount Kerkini on the 25th of June. Handicapped by the lack of artillery, the Greeks had to cross forests and wild terrain under enemy artillery. But the Greeks seized three hills and captured 9 heavy guns at bayonet point. By the 26th, the Greek artillery was in effect, and they made a successful attack on the main Bulgarian line. After many hours, the Bulgarians were beaten. Sadly, when the Greeks entered Stromnica, their eyes once again saw corpses, dead bodies, and pillaged homes, but the bulk of the population was spared because the Greek army arrived in time. 44 Bulgarian battalions from the eastern side of the Strimona had approached Sidirokastro, back then known as Demir Hisar, after the announcements of the Bulgarian defeat at the Battle of Kilkis and Lahana. On the 27th of June, these divisions attacked the Bulgarians in a ruthless battle at Vetrina, which began with an attack about 3 o'clock in the morning. The Evzones and the infantry battalions struck hard against the fortified positions of the Bulgarians at Neopetritsi, taking constant attack. By 8 o'clock in the morning, a general assault overwhelmed the Bulgarians. By 9 o'clock, Captain Georgios Papadopoulos led a heroic hand-to-hand combat, which resulted in his death. But his Evzones continued, shouting the classic cry, Aera. And it was called not Stipindo to Saranda, but here in the Battle of Sidirokastro, people were yelling Aera. While capturing enemy artillery and chasing the Bulgarians across the bridge, a massive rout of the Bulgarians followed. Sidirokastro was liberated on the same day, and so the campaign of that took place, that came to an end, and the city was spared. Now, a few days before, on the 23rd of June, the Navy had received orders to make a show of force in the port city of Kavala, which had been in Bulgarian hands since 1912. The purpose of this demonstration was to show the enemy that a full naval invasion would be possible, and followed by the landing of troops. So, on June 25th, the enemy concluded that the Greeks were going to make an attack, and so they got up and they left the town. And so, the next day, the three destroyers arrived, landed, and had no resistance whatsoever. By the 27th, Kavala was a free Greek city. In time for the arrival of the royal member of the family, a royal family member, to give a speech celebrating this event. And Venizelos was very happy that finally another port city was added to the list. So, we come near the end. The Battle of Sedis. Arriving in Sedis on the night of the 28th of June, the Greek army found a Bulgarian force, which was on a higher elevation. The Greeks found a devastated town. The people of Sedis had actually watched the earlier withdrawal of the Bulgarians on June 22nd and put together a home guard to protect themselves. When the Bulgarians returned on the 27th, they attacked the town with cannons and artillery. The townspeople were evacuated and taken to a hill, where they were demanded payment from each. Then they burned the town center, the Bulgarians, destroying 4,000 homes and 1,000 stores with 100 dead. The Greeks came in time to blast the remaining Bulgarian forces and to liberate the town. Upon entry, the citizens who had returned were very excited, very happy, and they began the long road of reconstruction so that Sedis can be built up again. On the morning of June 30th, a Bulgarian force surrounded the village of Voksato with the goal of plundering and murdering the wealthy Greek citizens. Using the excuse that they had been attacked by Greek scouts, the Bulgarians began to kill every villager they met, leaving about 650 dead, or in other words, one-third the population. They then poured gasoline on the houses and left behind them a blazing inferno. This atrocity became a front-page story in most international newspapers and gained the condemnation of the leaders of the world. This atrocity was the worst one they had seen. And to this day, if you're from Drama or from the area, when you visit Voksato, you know it's a very, very moving sight. And here you have orphans who lost their families coming together as a group to try to survive with the help of anybody who's willing to help them. On July 1st, the Greek army liberated Voksato and then the town of Drama. And we have the famous old building in Drama. The liberator was welcomed with the open arms of the people and the blessings of the much-loved metropolitan, Mitropolitis Agathangelos Konstantinidis, a charismatic personality who was the heart and soul of the Greek community. He was a worthy successor of the former Metropolite Chrysostomos of Dramas, Chrysostomos Kalafatis of Drama. Agathangelos was also involved in supporting the armed struggle against the Bulgarians and even risked his life many times. He too belongs to that exceptionable category of priests, bishops, and monks who did so much for the fortunes of the nation in time of military crisis. Αν διαβάσετε το λόγο του, είναι πολύ ενθαρρυντικός. A lot of excitement. Everything is full of emotion. On July 8th, the heroic six-day battle of the Kresna Gorge witnessed some of the most dramatic moments of the war. The Greek army had crossed the Strymona and invaded old Bulgaria, very close to Sofia. The consolidated Bulgarian army, composed of over 200,000 men, had been settled defensively at Simitli and launched attacks on both sides of the Greek army, pushing them down the Strymona and the Mestara River valleys. General Michail Savov was the Bulgarian field marshal. The Greeks deployed six infantry divisions and a cavalry brigade under Field Marshal Emmanuel Manousoyannakis. At noon, the two Greek divisions began their advance against the Bulgarian fortified positions on the Hasan Pasha height. They met the Bulgarians on the front line of defense. The Greek troops fixed the bayonets and fought hand to hand with the Bulgarians. There were severe casualties. On the next morning, the Bulgarians conducted strong counterattacks, trying to weaken the center of the Greek line. They exerted so much pressure that Manousoyannakis sent the 18th Infantry Regiment to their aid. And then, on the height of 1378, the famous location, 1378, the battle was epic. The fight turned to a savage bloodbath. The troops fought each other with rocks, bare hands, even their teeth. A Cretan soldier dropped his empty rifle and with his bayonet killed two Bulgarians before he was stabbed to death by five others. After the battle, the stab wounds on his dead body accounted for 22. Two Evzones, Sergeant Tolios and Private Makrakis of the 8th Evzone Division, fought alone against a Bulgarian platoon. After the battle, the stab wounds on Tolios' body were about 30. Makrakis was killed by an enemy machine gun volley. Around their dead bodies, a hill of Bulgarian corpses was formed. Two Evzone companies launched immediately an attack on the Bulgarians to avenge their deaths. For 2 days, this went on, this bloody battle. On the morning of the last day of the Battle of Kresna, the Bulgarians launched their final attack. It was pretty clear by now that this had gone too far. The Crown Prince, realizing that the Greeks held but could not continue, was thinking about bringing it to an end. One very sad note. The man whom King Constantine had called the hero of heroes, Major Ioannis Velisariou of the 9th Evzone Battalion, lay dead on height 1378. He was buried on the side of the battle. He left behind a distinguished military career and a great reputation for patriotism and self-sacrifice. It was said that he usually fought without any notice of the bullets that moved around him. His last words, "Forward, men, forward." The Greeks lost around 10,000 men fighting at Kresna, Simitli, and Zumaian. The Bulgarians had a similar number of casualties. Realizing that his forces were physically and morally exhausted, King Constantine, after contacting the Romanian allies, decided, after seeing the Bulgarian casualties and watching the progress of the Turks in the area, he sent word to Venizelos and said, "Let's put an end to this." And so, on July 31st of 1913, an armistice was signed. Look at the casualties. Bulgaria, First War, 14,000 killed. 19,000 disease, 50,000 wounded. Second War, 18,000 killed. Total, 32,000 in battle, 34,000 of disease, 110,000 wounded. Greece, 5,169 killed or dead, 23,502 wounded. You do the math, close to 7,700 men died as a result of both Balkan wars. Serbia, 36,550 killed. And look at the big one down here. Ottoman Empire, 50,000 killed in battle, 75,000 dead of disease, 100,000 wounded, and 115,000 prisoners of war. Greece got off very well. And so, we come to the end, the Treaty of Bucharest. At Bucharest, Venizelos met with his allies and received many of the liberated regions he had asked for. And here you have them in Bucharest, all the leaders of the winning side. Primarily, Venizelos wanted to make sure he got eastern Macedonia. Greece had to give up northern Epirus to the new Albanian state. Bulgarians kept western Thrace, but lost most of eastern Thrace and Macedonia. Here's an interesting statistic. Greece increased her population from 2.7 million to 4.4 million and increased her territory by 68%. Most importantly, the northern frontier Greece needed to keep a strong presence in the Balkans finally happened. Macedonia, Epirus, and the northern Aegean islands were united with Greece. And finally, the one thing that started it all, the state of Crete, the autonomous state of Crete, was finally united after a period of 15 years. And so we have here a last demonstration of solidarity, unity between the king and his prime minister. You know the rest after this, it's not going to be a happy time. The prime minister is going to go one way and the king is going to go the other. As I close, I have one more thing to do. I want to pay tribute at this time. I want to pay tribute to two men who played a very important role in these wars. And these two men are members of my family. A member of the Evzon Battalion, a man who served his country very well, a man who did what his country asked him to do, my grandfather, Michalis Stratigopoulos. My grandfather, who was born in Messenia and served in northern Greece, born in 1889 and died in 1975, served his country wonderfully. I'm proud that my father's here today to see this tribute to the man who fought at many important battles. He received awards from the king and Venizelos. This is the distinguished citation he received. If you look closely, you can see he fought at Kresna and Zumaya, that battle which had 10,000 dead Greeks, the bloodiest battle in the Balkan Wars. In the bottom right is the signature of Eleftherios Venizelos. And the medals he would have received are here. These are the medals of the Balkan Wars. So, to the man from Messenia who came to Macedonia and fought for the people there and fought at the side of his king, with pride and honor, I dedicate this. And also to another man, a man who served on the Averof, a man who, from Litochoro, my other grandfather, Mikhail Mavrudis, who was very friendly with the captains, who went with Votsis and torpedoed the Fetich Ibulent, with the same man who joined Kuduriotis in the battles across the Aegean Sea. And though he was a little younger, He served on the Avedov with pride. Mikhail Mavrudis was a proud member of one of the old families of Litochoro, and to this day, you speak of his name in Litochoro, and you know you're talking about one of the great sea captains. He also received much commendation for serving on the Avedov. Here is his diploma to Kivernito, and there's his picture in the top right. Now, I have to tell you, as like the last slide, the most proud moment I've ever had is 2 years ago when I went with my family to Litochoro, and we went to the Naftiko Museo Litochoro, and there on the wall with my son Dimitri, who's over there, he saw his grandfather's citation on the wall of the museum. For me, that is everything. So now, we have 4 generations from that time. My brother and his family also very proud, and my sister. And I'm sure you're all very proud of your family members who participate in these Balkan Wars. Tonight, I dedicate this to them. And I hope that the years ahead produce more great men, for truly, this was the greatest generation in Greek history in modern times. I want to thank you for your patience. Σας ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ. Να είστε καλά. Σας ευχαριστώ και για την υπομονή σας, κύριος Μοσοκάρδης.
Τα λόγια που θα πω είναι λίγα. Όντως, με μεγάλη λεπτομέρεια μας έδωσε να καταλάβουμε εμείς οι απόγονοι τι θα πει Έλληνας. Χαίρομαι ιδιαιτέρως που τη χάνεις να είσαι Μακεδόνας. Χαίρομαι ακόμη μια φορά που έχεις μια τόσο όμορφη οικογένεια και ήρθαν όλοι απόψε εδώ κοντά σε μας να θαυμάσουν αυτόν τον άνθρωπο που μας έδωσε μια μνήμη μέσα στο μυαλό μας να έχουμε την όμορφη πατρίδα μας και να πούμε στον Μιχάλη θερμά συγχαρητήρια, ο Θεός να σε έχει πάντοτε γέρο και να μας κάνεις ακόμα πιο πολλές διαλέξεις.
Ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ. Να είσαι καλά. Μεγάλη τιμή. Κύριε Βατσικούρα.
Και εγώ επίσης θέλω να σας ευχαριστώ για την ωραία παράσταση που σχετικά με αυτό το πρόγραμμα. Εκείνο που είχα να δείξω εδώ και ένα μήνα σχεδόν, είχα κάποιο Χρήστο Κότα, εγγονάς του Κότα και τα δυσέγγωνα. Τα έφερα εδώ.
Μπράβο, πολύ ωραία. Πολύ ωραία. Πολύ σπουδαίο πράγμα να είναι του Κότα τα εγγόνια εδώ.
Wow. Τα παπούτσια δεν τους άδειξα κάτω.
Τα παπούτσια είναι κάτω, ναι, είναι μέσα. Πολύ ωραίο πράγμα.